Welcome to Business Analytics. My name is Hari Rajagopalan, and I'm going to be your instructor for this course. In this series of lectures, we will be using Microsoft Excel as the main tool to analyze, visualize, and manipulate data. I hope all of you enjoy working with data as much as I do. Let's go ahead and jump into the program. While the tools and techniques used in business analytics have been around a long time in this galaxy, it was in 21st century that the impact of analytics started to be taken seriously. Actually, it was in 2012 when an angry father walks into a Target store, berating the store manager, asking him if Target is trying to encourage his teenage daughter to get pregnant. Apparently, Target had sent his daughter's coupons for maternity clothes and cribs. The manager profusely apologizes and the father walks away. 4 days later, the manager calls the father to apologize again. On the phone, though, the father is embarrassed. He says, "It turns out I don't know what my daughter is doing. She is due in August." Target, on analyzing the data from its shoppers, had noticed some useful patterns. Lotions, for example. Lots of people buy lotion, but Target noticed that women on the baby registry were buying larger quantities of the unscented lotion around the beginning of their second trimester. Another analyst noted that sometime in the first 20 weeks, pregnant women loaded up on supplements like calcium, magnesium, and zinc. Many shoppers purchase soap and cotton balls, but when someone suddenly starts buying a lot of scent-free soap and extra big bags of cotton balls, in addition to hand sanitizers and washcloths, it signals that they could be getting close to their delivery date. And the shopping habits change, and this signals with analytics you can predict with 87 to 90% accuracy when someone is going to be pregnant. Here is another example. Google can predict a flu outbreak faster than CDC. The idea behind Google Flu Trends was that by monitoring millions of users' health tracking behaviors online, the large number of Google search queries gathered can be analyzed to reveal if there was a presence of a flu-like illness in a population. Google Flu Trends compared these findings to historic baseline levels of influenza activity for its corresponding region and then reports the activity as either minimal, low, moderate, high, or intense. These estimates have been consistent with conventional surveillance data collected by health agency, both nationally and regionally. Now, this Google Flu Trends has been discontinued in 2015 because there were concerns on privacy. And let's take another example of analytics. Walmart officials revealed that the sales for strawberry Pop-Tarts increased 7 times as much as ahead of a hurricane, which is why they make sure their shelves are flush with strawberry Pop-Tarts before a hurricane. Pre-hurricane top-selling item is beer. There are so many cool things analytics can do to make predictions, but they can do much more. So let's take a look at the different types of analytics and look at what analytics actually means. So we are going to look at 3 types of analytics and a 4th one which kind of covers all 3. The first one we will talk about is descriptive analytics, then predictive, prescriptive, and finally risk analytics. While risk analytics actually covers all other 3, we are treating it separately because it introduces uncertainty and risk. If you take a look at this graph here, where x-axis is the level of difficulty and y-axis is value, we're trying to start with information, convert data into information which we can act on, And then we're trying to move to optimization, which has more value and is of a higher level of difficulty. And optimization will allow us to make the best decisions possible given the data. So here we have the three kinds of analytics. Descriptive analytics is pure information, what happened. And a lot of companies are in this realm of descriptive analytics. When you hear people talk about Tableau or Power BI, they're really talking about a tool set to describe your data, to visualize your data. The next stage is predictive analytics. Here, this contains powerful software like SPSS, SAS, SAS, R. All these kind of look at doing predictive analytics. This kind of focuses on what will happen in the future. So, descriptive analytics gives you the current position of the company. Predictive is your forecasts, your demand forecasts, things that will happen in the future or could happen. And then the last, most difficult part is prescriptive analytics. Very few companies are here. How can we make this happen with the best possible outcome? This comes under prescriptive analytics. So if you look at this here, descriptive comes under hindsight, predictive under insight, and prescriptive is foresight. And the risk analytics actually covers all these three. We face numerous decisions in life and business, and we can use computers to analyze the potential outcomes of these decision alternatives. In this course, we are primarily going to use spreadsheets as a tool of choice. And this is because everybody uses spreadsheets. All of you are used to Excel, and if you're not, there will be a small primer which introduces you to Excel. But essentially, all of you are used to Excel, and this is used pervasively throughout our business field. So, what is business analytics? It is a field of study that uses data, computer statistics, and mathematics to solve business problems. There were some other words for it in the past. It is also called operations research, management science, and decision science. The difference between these old terms and the new terms is predominantly the volume of data and the implementation of new tools from artificial intelligence. So, operations research, if you go back to the history, originated in military efforts during and before World War II. It was a decision that deals with the application of advanced analytical methods to help make better decisions. And we use a lot of mathematical modeling, statistical analysis, and mathematical optimization. So, to go through this course, you're going to do a lot of math, and I'll try to make it as easy as I can for you. Here are some examples of success stories for business analytics. It's used a lot in reducing cost, increasing revenue and profit. And here are a few examples that you can see. The Institute of Operations Research and Management Science gives the Franz Edelman Award to recognize the most outstanding project in analytics, management science, and OR. So let's talk a little bit about the fundamentals. All you're doing in business analytics is building a model. And what is a model? A model is a set of mathematical relationships and logical assumptions implemented in a computer as an abstract representation of a real-world object or phenomena. And here we are going to use these models in Microsoft Excel. So Excel spreadsheet is the tool we're going to use, and we're going to use it because it is convenient. It's pervasive, everybody uses it, and it's pretty powerful. There are different model types. You have mental models, like arranging the furniture in a house, and we kind of think about it in our head. We have visual models, like blueprints or roadmaps. We have physical scale models, buildings, kind of prototypes. But where we are going to focus on is on mathematical models. And this is what we'll be studying in this class. Some of the characteristics of a model is that they are simplified versions of what they represent. So remember, you're abstracting reality and you're simplifying, and it does not take everything into picture, but it accurately represents relevant characteristics of the object or decision studied. And therefore, it basically reduces the imprecise human language into precise and consistent mathematical formulas. And really what you're doing is a function of translating. The benefits of modeling are it's economy. It's cheaper to analyze problems using models than actually building them and it not working. It's timely. It delivers needed information a lot more quickly than their real world counterparts. It's feasible. You can do models to do things which would be impossible otherwise. You end up with improved decision making and you gain some insight and understanding about the problem. Let's take a simple example of a mathematical model. Profit is equal to revenue minus expense. A very basic model. And here we actually represent profit as a function of revenue and expense. Or Y, which is represented by profit, is a function of X1 and X2, where X1 is revenue, X2 is expense. Let's take another example of revenue and let's break it down further. Revenue is selling price multiplied by sales. So revenue is a function of selling price and sales. So X1 in turn is a function of X3 and X4, where X3 is selling price and X4 is sales. Similarly, expense, which you remember was X2, is equal to fixed cost plus variable cost multiplied by quantity. So expense is a function of fixed cost, variable cost, and quantity, which makes X2 a function of X5, X6, and X7. So you could say that Y is a function of X3, X4, X5, X6, and X7, because X1 is a function of X3 and X4, X2 is a function of X5, X6, and X7. So here is a generic model where Y, which is a dependent variable or the bottom line performance measure, is a function of a bunch of independent variables. And this function here is the functional defining the relationship between X and Y. So the process we are going to use for solving problems is the first step is always going to be identify the problem. Second, we formulate and implement a model. Third step is analyze the model. We test the results. And if the results are good, we implement the solution. But if we end up with unsatisfactory results, we go back to formulation and implementation of the model. So these mathematical models are used for structured aspects of decision making. But there are parts which cannot be structured easily, and those require intuition and judgment. And the assumption that human beings are rational is false. Human beings are not rational, and I'll walk you through a bunch of examples where we show irrational behavior of human beings. But it's important to understand that because mathematical models cannot take into account the irrationality of human beings. And so there is a other component in decision making which has got nothing to do with the mathematical modeling. The first example is called an anchoring effect. This arises when trivial factors influence initial thinking about a problem, and decision makers usually under-adjust from their initial anchor. Let me take an example. If you have a group of people, let's say randomly pick about 100 people, and ask them to guess, very quickly, guess the answer for this question, you would get an answer. But if you take another group of people, randomly, could be 100, 200, and ask them to guess the answer for this, you would get a group of answers. Now, this group would, in general, guess an answer which is a lot higher than this group, even though the numbers are the same. And they are anchoring on the very first number, on 1 or 8. This is very useful when it comes to negotiations. If you can get somebody to anchor on a smaller number, that's a very good way of getting them to agree to a lower price. Now, if you are trying to buy a house, real estate agents know very well about this anchoring effect, because normally a buyer or a seller has a number in their head, and they would walk away from the deal even if it's like $1,000 off. So the anchoring effect is very, very strong and significant. Here are some cartoons which talk about the anchoring effect, and it's kind of funny. The framing effect refers to how decision makers view a problem from a win-loss perspective. The way a problem is framed often influences choices in very irrational ways. So here's a funny cartoon where a young kid comes and says, "Sir, should I be punished for something I have not done?" The teacher goes, "Of course not. What happened?" And he says, "I haven't done my homework." And here is a great example of framing. We see this all the time on TV. Depending upon which side is in power, one channel talks about glasses half empty and the other side talks about how the glass is half full. This is a great example of framing the problem. Let's continue with this example of framing effects. I'm going to give you two scenarios, and in each scenario you have two decisions you've got to make. So the first scenario, you've been given $1,000 and you have to choose between A, getting $500 more immediately, or B, you can flip a coin, receive $1,000 more if you get heads, or you don't get any if you get tails. And then scenario two is, you have been given $2,000 and you have to choose between giving back $500 immediately, or you flip a coin, give back $0 if it's heads, and give $1,000 back if it is tails. Now I want you to look at these two situations and just very quickly, without sitting and analyzing it, figure out whether you'll choose A or B here or A or B here. And what we know from data analyzed is that most people would essentially go for flipping a coin here when they're receiving $1,000 more. They'll take a chance. And in this case, they're less likely to take a chance, and a lot of people would give back $500 immediately. Now, this is irrational because in both situations, it's the same outcome. You have the initial state, you can accept the offer and get $1,500, or you can flip a coin, and with heads you get $2,000 and tails you get $1,000. But yet, when you have to give back money, you're less likely to do that rather than when you're gaining money. You're more likely to gamble when you are gaining some money rather than giving back money. So this is an example of framing effect where people behave differently even though the outcomes are the same. It's what the initial state is, they'll decide whether they accept the offer or whether they will gamble. Let's talk about confirmation bias, because we see this a lot. A lot of us collect data to fit our preconceived bias. We discount data which does not fit with our bias, and we overvalue the data that fits with your bias, and we essentially don't throw away data which does not fit with their bias. Now, why is this dangerous? Well, this leads to stereotyping. It leads to a lot of false conclusions, because we're essentially going and finding data which fits with our hypotheses. So here is an example. The person is looking on the internet, and essentially the site says, "You're right, everyone else is an idiot." And of course, the person will trust that site. Here is another example of the witch trials of confirmation bias. And here's another funny example, third one, of confirmation bias. So if you look at it, here is your belief. Here is what's confirmed with the facts. And here is a whole part which is not confirmed. And a lot of people undervalue the facts. So it doesn't really matter how much facts you give. People will most likely discount it if it doesn't confirm with their belief. There's also the last one, which is called Kruger-Dunning syndrome. And this happens a lot. So a confidence in a field or an area dramatically increases with a little bit of knowledge. And then as we learn more, it drops, and then you understand the complexity of it, right? Which is why when people are exposed to a little bit of knowledge, they seem to have a high certainty of the answers to things. So here is why this happens. This green square is what you know, and the purple area is what you think you don't know. But what you really don't know is this red square. So the increase in expertise actually exposes you to a lot of things you did not know. Which is why you will see a lot of times experts couch things. They don't come out and say, yes, A is going to happen. It is going to rain. They're going to talk in terms of likely, the probability, the chance it may not, because they understand that it is complicated. Often Kruger-Dunning syndrome affects experts when they are looking at non-experts. Experts also assume non-experts know more because of the amount of confidence non-experts show. So this is a very dangerous syndrome, and you can see this in your day-to-day, in your workplace, in media, on Facebook. You can see that a lot. So the last part I want to talk about when you're making data-driven decisions is the difference between decisions and outcomes. Structured modeling approach to decision-making helps us make good decisions, but cannot guarantee good outcomes. A lot of times people confuse between good decisions and good outcomes. They assume that good things happen to people who make right decisions. Well, that's not true. So you can make good decisions or bad decisions, and your outcome quality can be good or bad. You can make good decisions and have good outcomes, which is your deserved success, but you could have bad luck, and you've done everything right and still not do well. And there is a probability there, and that's basically bad luck. You can make very bad decisions and have good outcomes. That's just dumb luck. I mean, my uncle used to say, hey, I've smoked every day since I was 20. I had 3 packs a day, and I'm 75, and I'm healthiest, and that's just dumb luck. It wasn't good decisions. You can make bad decisions and have bad outcomes, and that's poetic justice. The probability you're going to have good outcomes is higher when you make good decisions, and the probability you're going to have bad outcomes happens when you make bad decisions. But there's always, every individual decision can have a different outcome. So finally, this gives you a quick overview of business analytics and what we're going to do. The roadmap for this course, we're going to start off with descriptive analytics. we are going to move to predictive analytics from descriptive analytics. Then we move on to prescriptive analytics. And in the last, we do risk analytics. If we have time, we'll talk about some other decision-making tools which have nothing to do with analytics. And with this, we finish the introduction to analytics.